Good morning, everybody. Great to be here, and actually great to see how much things are going on around Transmart and how mature the platform is becoming. I'm going to present some stuff to you on the ASR Genie project, but actually I will make a bridge together, and that's something that I often do, is actually looking back at why we are doing this, because we're doing this, of course, because technology is fun to work on, etc. But in the end, it's a means to an end, and it's not a goal in itself. And the end goal that we are working on, whether we're doing biomedical research or whether we're doing research infrastructure development or research IT, is to get better outcomes for patients tomorrow than we have today. And the paradigm for getting that better outcome, of course, is personalized medicine. And in the basics, personalized medicine is a very simple approach, as you can see over here. We have patients, and they have disease symptoms. They respond to a drug or they do not respond to a drug. And if we have a better understanding of the underlying biology, the mechanisms, then actually we can improve the outcome of these patients. Well, that's a great theory, of course, but if you look in daily practice, and for instance, my daily practice, I'm a pathologist, so I make diagnoses, a lot of them cancer diagnoses, and we have to say something about prognosis of patients. And if you look how we're doing that, of course, we would be keen to use biomarkers. And if you look in PubMed, for instance, for biomarkers that can tell us something about the prognosis for patients who have been operated for colorectal cancer, you can find more than 3,000 proof of concept papers in there. But then if you do the reality check and see what we are using in daily practice, then that's what you see over here. A biomarker that is based on formaldehyde, candle wax, watercolor paint, and an instrument designed in the 17th century. Simple H&E stain sections. So the point I want to make is that we're facing a real issue here, a gap to bring innovations from research to care. The infame innovation gap. And of course that is a multifactorial problem, but one of the key issues behind the problem is fragmentation. And fragmentation occurs also in multiple dimensions here. It's fragmentations of the studies we are conducting that are often therefore underpowered, fragmentation in all of the IRB regulations that we have to deal with, that makes it very difficult to collaborate on multi-center studies, but of course also fragmentation on data, and that is what brings us together here, of course. And so in that perspective, data sharing is a key to the solution to making translational research or personalized medicine research or precision medicine more productive. And this slide is about FAIR, and Nicholas has already introduced that concept, making not just dumping your data somewhere on a site that is publicly accessible in theory, but actually make it accessible in practice by making data findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable. And what that means is complying to standards. And well, we heard before that cats don't like to be herded, but in the end, researchers are not really cats, they are humans, and they can actually be well conditioned. And one way to condition researchers is actually by telling them what is needed to get them their next grant. So the funders are key to the solution here. If you look how we do that compliance now, then actually we're introducing compliance after the fact. We apply standards after we have generated the data, and we call that curation, and basically that's a waste of time and money. So what should be the compliance of the future? That basically should be compliance by design, applying standards as you go and have them integrated into the research process. So let's have a look at the research process, because I believe that actually is very common and standard for almost all patient-centered translational research. So we have participants in a biobank, for instance, or in a cohort, or patients entering the clinic, and they undergo standard procedures. And these standard procedures yield data in the phenotype domain, clinical data from the electronic health record, images. They yield samples, and samples go along with metadata, ending up in a biobank catalog. And on these samples, we do all kind of experiments, ranging from simple PCRs and ELISAs to very complex whole genome sequencing. And actually, this is then the four categories of data that you get from that. It's not more complicated than that. And actually, that process can be repeated over time. Patients actually can and do enter clinics over on multiple occasions, and then this process is repeated. But when you have these data, then actually to arise at arrive at a true translation research, you need to make the interaction between the correlation between the phenotype data and the experimental data. That is the holy grail data integration, and that also often involves integrating with external data sources, and only after that you can do your downstream analysis and produce your scientific output, generate IP, improve healthcare, and also interact with the patients. So this is the standard process. And if you want to introduce that compliance by design, well, it's good to look at best practices around. And I think one best practice around in compliance by design is what we all have started to do with our office work. Whether we liked it or not, we all have ended up with Microsoft Office. And actually, that has by design made us comply with a large amount of standards, and sometimes we even still like it. So actually, we took this example and tried to translate that to that process of translational research, and that is this scheme that you've seen on a number of slides already and on a number of posters. And I stole the quote from Nicholas in his previous presentation, because what is key to make fair data stewardship easy, and that's exactly what we've tried to do here. So what you see here are again the same categories: clinical data, imaging data in two flavors, clinical imaging and pathology imaging, biobank sample data, and then experimental data. And what we've done for all of these categories is not developing new software, but looking for best practices around, preferably open source. And that is why in the data integration layer, which you see over here, Transmart has ended up, but also cBioPortal. Rather than developing new tools, we actually focused on the interaction of the interconnection between these tools. And that it works, you can see over here. So over the last 5 years, our user base has actively grown to almost 3,000 users now. But that is not where we aim to stop in the Netherlands. So this is a nice intermediate step, but we want to take that further because we think there are still issues between an issue to make the link between research infrastructures, like we are sitting here, and end users. So I want to play a short animation video, 3 minutes. So I hope you can survive that to show an initiative that we have launched in the Netherlands. I should have sound here, actually. I should have checked that on beforehand. Sorry, perhaps I stop. Can I have some assistance for the sound, please? Anyone up there? Sorry for this. I should have done that. Someone is coming.
1 second.
Yeah. I don't see an audio cable here.
You could restart.
Okay, but is there an audio connection then?
Do you have it plugged into your sound?
No, I don't see it over here, actually. Oh, it's in there. Okay, good. Thanks. Not much happening.
One second. Is your computer getting the audio levels well?
This is partly due to our biological differences. For example, our genetic...
Does this work?
Everybody wants to live a long and healthy life. Nevertheless, each of us will get sick sometime. When that happens, we want the best possible treatment. But what is best for one person may cause problems for another. The disease course and treatment response differ for each of us. This is partly due to our biological differences, for example, our genetic characteristics. If we could predict disease course and treatment response based on biological factors, we could offer each of us a tailored treatment. This is called personalized medicine. Similarly, we can promote health and prevent disease, personalized health. To enable personalized medicine and health, scientists study large groups of patients and healthy citizens for longer periods of time. They investigate how individual biological differences influence our health. Over 1 million Dutch people have already made biomaterial and health data available for such research. For instance, the relationship between genetic characteristics and the probability of success of a certain chemotherapy is studied. Or the probability of getting diabetes and how to prevent this. In the Netherlands, these studies are performed at numerous locations, usually independent from each other. This is inefficient, especially because data of many citizens and high-end technology from multiple research disciplines are required to properly map such relationships. To improve collaboration and data sharing, a new generation research infrastructure is required. Therefore, several Dutch research organizations have jointly developed the Health RI initiative. Health RI stands for Health Research Infrastructure. It offers a clear vision and roadmap to establish a single interconnected national infrastructure for personalized medicine and health research. Health RI organizes this infrastructure and implements the Dutch Open Science policy by making knowledge, equipment, and research data optimally accessible for research. An active role for us as citizens is an essential starting point. This requires secure and user-friendly technology, which we can use to personally participate in research while being assured that our privacy is protected. Health RI already is an important goal for many organizations in the Netherlands. To be truly successful, we need to invest and join forces now, from industry to government, and from citizen to academy. This is the only way to realize sustainable and affordable personalized medicine and health. The initiative aims to provide health benefits for everyone, impetus to Dutch science and innovation, and an active Dutch involvement in European initiatives.
Thank you. And what is also very good, and what we're very happy about, is all of these organizations nationally that actually are supporting this, many different categories of stakeholders. So back to my presentation. So let me see, where were we? So we believe that this approach actually can be a very important bridge over this gap to actually get innovations to patients. And of course, it also is an important basis, we believe, to not have to reinvent the wheel every time over and over again when you start to share data, but actually have a solid basic system to build upon. And that is in the situation of the European Open Science Cloud that Nicholas was already referring to, but also for instance basis to interact with the AHR Genie project. And that's what I'll talk about in the rest of my presentation. So the AHR Genie project is also about precision medicine and improving that and improving clinical decision making, again, and by doing the same things, linking genotypes with phenotypes. It uses for that actually data that have been generated in daily clinical practice. So they are real life data. So Genie, you could say, is about real life cancer data sharing. And at the current stage, these are the institutes participating in Genie: Memorial Sloan Kettering, Dana-Farber, Johns Hopkins, Vanderbilt, MD Anderson, Gustave Roussy in Paris, Princess Margaret in Toronto. And from the Netherlands, there is a multicenter initiative on cancer sequencing, clinical cancer sequencing, which is called CPCT. And at this stage, the Netherlands Cancer Institute is the representative on their behalf. This is more than the sum of the parts, as the title says. So these institutes actually are leaders in the field. So that helps to set the stage for such an initiative. And it, of course, is an initiative that's going to yield value to multiple stakeholders, multiple types of groups involved, the participants, of course, because they can improve their research efforts, they can ask questions, and we're seeing that already at the pilot stage that they would not be able to ask in their own series only, simply because the variants are too infrequent, very much like what Nicholas was referring to, what is happening in with the beacons in the Global Alliance for Genomics and Health when it is about germline genomics. Industry, of course, and also research payers. So the system behind it actually is quite straightforward. What the workflow is shown over here. So there's a limited clinical data set that is collected and provided, and of course then the molecular data. And those are submitted to Synapse, who take care of the curation, and then made available and presented in cBioPortal, and then there is an embargo stage at which the consortium members can look at the data, and then after that they will go public. So these are the informatics strategic partners, Sage and cBioPortal, and it would of course be great if we could involve with them from the Transmart community one way or another. So I think this is certainly something to consider. It is not only about the infrastructure, it's not only about IT, it is also about resolving a lot of the legal and ethical issues. A coordinating center, which is actually headed by Sean Sweeney at the AACR, and also the fact actually that the AACR is, I think, the probably most prominent cancer research organization, takes this initiative and attaches its name to it is very very supportive. There are a number of obligations when it comes to the data that need to be provided. So the participating centers should come up with, for all of these cases, with molecular data, being the single nucleotide variants, indels, insertions and deletions, the pathology report, and other diagnosis features, and copy number data when they are available, and of course, metadata on multiple levels. As to the clinical data collected, that is a HIPAA limited clinical data set, which probably means more for you over here in the US than for me, but it is a standardized data set. So what we've learned, for instance, from TCGA, that When you have enough budget and you have enough samples, then it is relatively easy to produce the sequencing data, but it only becomes meaningful if you have the right phenotype data along with it. So at the at the first stage of data release, which will be soon, actually these are the data that are going to be made available: gender, age, ethnicity, cancer type, etc. I think one of the most important slides is this one, because this shows, I think, a quite impressive number of more than 19,000 cases of which the clinical data and the sequencing data will be made available. And evidently, the frequency correlates to the prevalence of the diseases. So from left to right, you have colorectal, you have lung, breast, colorectal, and then to the end more rarer diseases. And all of these 19,000 cases then can be explored actually using cBioPortal, which has a very intuitive user interface. So the timelines of the AACR Genie project are shown over here. Basically, the plans were launched in November 2015, and now 1 year later we are about to release the first data set, and at the same time there will be an episode of extending the number of participants, and next to that there is also a number of sponsored research agreements in place and studies ongoing. And this timeline goes until November 2020. Well, Genie is not on its own in this domain. There are multiple initiatives on data sharing, and they all have their highlight features and their differences. And what is important to realize that actually participating in Genie is not mutually exclusive with participating in these other initiatives. So the as to the sustainability, the initiative has started with a startup grant from the American Association for Cancer Research, and the Genie organization, which is headed by Charles Sawyers, has been very active and also successful in raising additional funds. As you can see here, there are multiple approaches to secure those funds, either through philanthropy or research agreements or participating in funding schemes, for instance, in the Moonshot Against Cancer project or what have you. So, as I mentioned already, the first release of data will be in November 2016. Actually, I'm not sure, I don't know the exact date. If Mariska is around, she may know, but I don't see her. Well, this was this is a picture from a tweet about something which is very familiar to what we have been discussing here, because this was the final curation of the data set. And with that, I think Genie is setting the stage and really a powerful initiative with large numbers from an influential organization and with a leading institution. So I really think this is going to have an impact. So I would like to end here, and I'll try to answer your questions. If they become too difficult, then we have to refer to Mariska. And if they even get more difficult, then I would like to point you to the email address of Sean Sweeney, who's running the operations of the Genie project. Thank you. The panel. Good.
Sorry. So one of the things that we ran into with eTrix, which was honestly for me was just mind-boggling, is we went out to all the IMI projects a couple years ago and basically said, through Reinhardt's organization, we basically said, we will curate for you any public studies that you're interested in, and we'll do that essentially for free from IMI programs. And my concern at the time was that we were going to get inundated by requests, and essentially Reinhard's group was, who had some important work supporting, you know, client projects was just going to be inundated. And in the end, we got, I think, zero interest. And I've been kind of struggling, which honestly was worse, right? I would rather have been inundated. And I've been struggling to understand why that's the case. And it could be something rather pragmatic, like the way we marketed it, but it's not like, but we did put some time and effort into thinking about how you reach out to these programs. And it's almost sort of the reverse of if you have you offer to make the data available, you offer to make the data available at a low price or a zero price, is there still resistance? And maybe it's not even resistance, but is there still a reluctance to use the data? Maybe because there's not a clear fit for how people would actually introduce it to their research. And I'm wondering if you've seen that on your projects, and if you have any thoughts about how you could encourage people to actually use data that might be available to them. Anyway, thank you.
So as to your point, why instead of being inundated, researchers actually did not approach eTrix and come with their data. I think one of the issues is that for many researchers in daily practice, this still has not priority for them. And they do also not really get a stimulus for this. It's not mandatory still in many of the grants. They still get their budgets. Certainly if the grants have already been funded and you come up with this after the fact, then I think it's going to be, you're going to get less response than when, for instance, and that is what CTMM has done. They have actually advocated this quite actively. And another thing that might be different in how things have been, how the workflow has been in eTrix compared to Trade, is that you've tried to provide this this office suite approach, this compliance by design, early on. So there were many researchers that when they started, they not necessarily were interested in having their data ending up in Transmart. They just wanted to have an easy and well-supported electronic data capture tool. So they ended up in Open Clinica. And now things are maturing, and now data sharing is becoming more of age. They find themselves actually to be part of an environment that also facilitates this. So that would be my responses.
There's not that many studies around, I would say, that you really could get started with.
So it may just be that there's not enough studies that have the requisite amount of valuable to others. So we may not have enough of a pool of valuable studies. So the way that we had looked at it, we had made some assumptions that internally, roughly about 50 studies that are geostudies that are purposely requested. And obviously they're related. And you load them in the Transmart, and presumably that's. And I think we had that expectation when we made that offer that there would be, if not grand, longitudinal clinical studies that would. Interest was thinking about this offer. And but that could be very well the case, that there's just not enough out there that's scientifically rigorous or scientifically comprehensive enough to be of interest for a lot of folks. And if they want to go get a geostay, they just go get a geostay.
I think another Raymond, if I may, another aspect is also that I think until the versions that are now upcoming with SmartR in Transmart, the wow factor of Transmart was perhaps not that high, and not so high as, for instance, for C Bioportal, that a lot of people actually also see at. And also a point that we discussed at the membership meeting yesterday. So if you, for instance, go to the ACR annual meeting, you see a lot of presentations that have pictures of cBioPortal data in there, and hardly any on Transmart.